Thank you all so much for having me. Let me ask you, if I may, how many of you have heard me speak before, or specifically last year? Just a couple? Okay. You've heard me. I've been asked, or I'm asked in a lot of places, and the reason I say this, I'll get to my point. Everywhere I go, or a lot of places I go, people ask me if I'll tell the Max Kinnick story. And I did that last year, and I don't want to belabor that or wear it out. But would that be okay if I told that again? I do think it pertains to this that we're going to talk about. And so if that's okay with y'all, everybody good with that? We'll see how much time we have in the end, and I'll be brief. But I do want to share that story with those that have asked me to do it, so I'm going to go ahead and do it. So thank you for having me here. I have a stool also. I noticed that I moved around last year. Camera couldn't follow me. I'm being taped. So I'm going to try to sit down more, okay, and not put my back to the audience and all that other stuff. But thank you so much for having me. It is great to be in a room of heroes. And clearly, we're at the last class of the day. Some have already moved to the room in preparation of a wild, raging night on the town in Frisco, Texas, or at the open house given by Pierce. So y'all be a part of that. Let me just tell you a little bit about the city of Taylor and the Taylor Fire Department specifically. I am their chief. I've been there. It'll be 4 years in May. I cannot believe it's been that long. What a great, great journey it's been. Yeah, that's what I said, 4 years in May. Time has just flown. But the city of Taylor Fire Department was actually founded in 1886. Our city was founded in 1876, but it started with 153 volunteers running out of five companies. I tell everybody it's amazing how good we are today, because today we can do it with 23-2. Budgets have gotten smaller, but we're, I guess, not fighting that much fire or whatever. But we're smaller, but we're growing, and things are happening at a rapid pace in Taylor, and it's a joy to be there. That picture that I showed you before was our first major fire station. Actually, the first one was at the corner of 2nd and Main Street, which it was just a one-room, one-bay horse-drawn station. And then, of course, our first fleet of motorized apparatus, the truck in the middle is a 1916 American LaFrance utility truck, what I believe is probably the oldest utility truck in the nation, if certainly not in the state of Texas. But it still has good compression in the engine, and we just bought new tires for it in a process of refurbishing it, bringing it back to its glory. I bought four tires, $4,100. So do the math. And that was a 43% discount. So there. So if you're planning on doing an old truck and bringing it back to school, just get your checkbook out and get ready. But I think we're going to do this. I think we're going to make it. And certainly we've progressed, and I don't know why this slide takes time to get there, but we've progressed and moved forward. I pause on this slide just to tell you that I'm so very proud of our honor guard. Unfortunately, they're called to go all over the state and help officiate during tragic deaths, line of duty deaths, things like that. Our honor guard commander was very influential in Brian's, and he actually served up a lot of the mission efforts in West originally. He and I were the first two line of duty death members on the ground in West. And these guys they're just great, great things. But I pause on this picture to ask you to look at that footwork. And they look like that all the way. These guys are sharp and sharp at what they do, and I'm so very, very proud of them and what they represent for our profession. And I'll get back to this slide. This is on the September the 11th Memorial Walk, something that we've done ever since the terrorist attacks of September the 11th in 2001. And I'm going to come back to that, but that's on Main Street. And, of course, we lose our share of structures and fight our share of fires, but we train hard and work hard. We certainly look good in our uniform, I think, and we're very proud of the equipment and the facilities that we have. So it's a good life in Taylor. I'm very much home, and I'm so proud to be there. We have four statements that we base every decision on in our organization. These are actually found on the walls of the station, serving with pride. If you've heard me speak before, I said this before, we believe we are serving with pride, and if not, we need to change that. Are we? We ask ourselves that every day. And then we take ownership of every step that we take and every decision that we make. Whether it be right or wrong, we own it. and we'll do the best that we can to make it right if it was the wrong decision. But in doing so, we believe that we will then be seeking excellence in everything that we do. We'll make our department stronger, our city safer, and our profession better if we follow those guidelines. And in the end, of course, in doing so, we will make a difference, which was the title of my discussion when I had the pleasure of meeting with y'all last year. So this year, our main topic, of course, is influence. And I'm so proud of what TEEX and Frisco have done collectively or cooperatively, but specifically TEEX, and that they come up with one theme or one word, if you will, and bring a lot of great people, not necessarily myself included, but some great, great instructors in to speak on that one topic. And through this week, we can all gain insight and differing opinions, if you will, on the same topic. And so we go home richer, wiser, and well-educated because of that. I took this out of Webster, although I didn't give him credit in the slide. I guess that's illegal. But I would ask that we cross out argument and or force or personality, and we focus mainly on the example. The examples of the leaders within this room and those that are around us. And what influence do you have on the people that are around you each and every day in the way you conduct your life, in the way that you conduct your business, and in the way you run your ship? So I'm going to ask you a question. I struggle with this. I'll pause now and tell you that the other night my wife and I were at a restaurant. I'm getting older, okay? And just from last year, I got older, a whole nother year. But I got gray hair, and I don't know. So when I look in the mirror sometimes, I really don't know who this cat is that's looking back at me. I still feel very young inside, right? Some of you, you've got to know what I'm talking about. There's some old dudes in here. Come on. You know what I'm talking about. You look in the mirror and you think, man, I don't feel that old, but I'm getting older. So we're at the restaurant the other night, and I'm eating, and I'm fixated on this guy across the room. Not that I always look at guys, okay? But I'm looking at this cat because I'm thinking, is he about the same age as me or not? Because if he is, I'm super old, okay? So I asked my wife, Diane, that guy right there, my age or older? This is what she does. Your age? Wait, you didn't even look at him. What? Look, because that dude is old. No, he's probably about your age. So I know I'm getting older, and I tell you that just to ask this question. How many of you are in the room with 20 years or more of experience? Okay, good, a good number. 15 years or more experience. Okay, we're pretty much wrapping up the room. 10 years or more, just a few. Anybody with less than 5 years? Okay, thank you all for being here, by the way. Kudos to you. And keep it up. The majority of the people in this room are 20 years or greater, 15, okay? 15 years or greater. So let me ask you a question. Tuesday, September 11th, 2001, what happened? The World Trade Center attacks, right? The worst attack on American soil since Pearl Harbor. 343 souls lost in the fire profession. Thousands lost, but 343 firefighters lost. You all remember that day, right? Friday, December the 3rd, 1999. Do what? Worcester, Massachusetts. Very good, by the way. I could get you $5. Hang on just a minute. I'll come back to you. Worcester, Massachusetts. Did you know that? Cold storage fire. That's where the fire chief actually took a bold stand. They kept sending firefighters in, kept getting them lost. He finally just went to the door. Stood in front of the door and said, nobody else goes in. Nobody else will die today. Do what? Absolutely. The bravest thing done that day was a fire chief that said, stop. Friday, July the 1st, 1988, what happened? Hackensack, New Jersey. Man, you are good. You got it down. Hackensack, New Jersey, changed the way that we fight fire today, bowstring construction. By the way, 2 weeks after that, every fire you fought was bowstring construction. Remember those? Come on. You remember that. It changed the way we did business. Five firefighters lost their life that day. And there's a whole litany of things that happened on that fire that were extremely tragic. But we should have learned from those. In fact, we did learn from those. But I'm not so sure that we're passing that message forward. Stay with me. My revelation came on September the 11th, 2013. On the morning of September the 11th, 2013, Diane came in like she does every morning. She rubs my arm, goes, "Honey, the coffee's ready. It's time for you to get up, go to work, so I can sit around the house and whatever." I don't know what she does when I'm gone. But and so this morning, I did just that. I woke up, but I paused a moment, and I just reflected back 12 years ago that day. What was going through the mind of those people that day? I know what was going through my mind. I was about to get off duty, actually leaving the station. But what about those people? What about those firemen? Well, the firemen, I can pretty well imagine, probably started their day just like you and I did, and that is that they were focused on what needed to be done, not what could happen. Okay? But I took just an extra moment before I crawled out of bed, and I just gave thanks to my Lord for allowing me to wake up that morning, to bless me with that day. But also I said, "Father, let us just all reflect on the memory of those that are lost. Make this a special day. Help me to do that." So I roll out of bed. A few minutes later, I'm in the living room, dining room thing, whatever I am, where I eat my coffee. She really makes better coffee than that. I was drinking my coffee. And I was reading headlines of remembrance of September the 11th and going through that, when just a few moments later my cell phone rings. And I will tell you, in Taylor, we have a policy. We're a small organization. We have a policy because we've had some issues in the past. They don't continue, but we've had issues in the past of company officers not doing everything they were supposed to do. And so when a company officer calls in sick, I just ask that they call the fire chief. It makes it a little bit harder to call in sick sometimes, you got to admit. So my phone rings. It's a company officer, September the 11th, 2013. I scratch my eye. Not going to be able to make it in. What? Scratch my eye. Can't come to work. Really? Yeah, well, I hope you get to feeling better. I hung up. But I have to tell you, when I hung up, I thought to myself, really, on September the 11th of all days, when we're about to host a county event, which we've done, as I said, every year since those attacks, bring every department in the county, and it's a big deal, 500 firefighters at times. It's a big deal. I'll tell you, that's me walking to the right here. You're thinking, why is that chief not in line? Well, I have a reason. I'm actually going over. There's a New York City firefighter standing on the corner, retired, was serving that day, standing there in his full Class A uniform. I'd heard he was going to be there, and we did some research. This real cat, you know. And so I thought, I'm going to have this guy walk with us. He came in line. He walked with us. He cried from that point all the way around three blocks till we got back to the square and finally calmed down once we stopped marching. It was a very meaningful, very, very moving event. But I can't believe this company officer is calling in sick. So, okay, I got it. Go on. So I get ready. I go to work. I walk into my office. I'm not there 10 minutes. And another company officer walks into my office and starts asking me to make a decision about a staffing issue that had absolutely nothing to do with the citizens of Taylor or their protection or safety that day. Quite frankly, it was a decision that he should have made himself. He just didn't want to. And I'm not speaking bad about him. He would stand here and tell you, well, I guess I am. But he would stand here and tell you, I mucked up that day. I probably did the wrong thing. But he was asking me to make a decision that he was not willing to make himself. And quite frankly, it was his responsibility to do it. And I'm going to just be honest with you. I did what y'all should never do, and I lost it. I don't scream and hit my, you know, I don't beat my desk with my fist or anything, but I did. I lost it. I said, I tell you what, get up. We're going next door. We're going to have a meeting. Now, I knew that the other station was there. They were about to do some training and some other stuff. The other station was there, and I had a couple of scragglers from the shift prior to that that were still there, just, you know, mingling around, drinking coffee or whatever. So my audience was going to be fairly large for me to get my point across. And the whole time I'm walking over, I'm thinking, I am going to convince these guys or remind these guys what today is all about. Y'all come in here. Get around the table. So they're all around this big kitchen table. Some of them are leaning up against the wall. Others on the counter. Some of them are sitting down. And I began to educate them. Where were you 12 years ago today? Where were you 12 years ago today? Hold that. That's good. I'm asking them around the room, where were you 12 years ago today? What do you think I heard? Well, Chief, I was in high school English class. They called me out. They turned it on the speaker and they brought us in the auditorium and let us watch it on TV. Well, Chief, I was about to enroll in EMT school. I was thinking about being a fireman, but I knew I had to get my EMT certification done. I was actually standing in line hoping I could get enrolled in that next class. Well, Chief, I was driving a truck. Wow. It hit me like a brick. Now, there were a few that said I was coming on duty or I was going off duty, but a very small few, two or three. I finally realized it. These guys don't get it. At least that's what I thought. They don't get it. Now, fact is, they're American citizens. They were alive that day. They understand the impact of those attacks. We all do. It changed our world as much as it changed our profession. But what I was convinced of is they'll never understand what September the 11th means to me because they weren't wearing a uniform that day. They don't get it. After I thought about it a little bit, I thought, you know what? I'm the one that really doesn't get it. This whole time I'm thinking I'm in that same generational error as they are. I'm not. I'm past that. It is true, and I'll talk about it here in a minute, that our society is evolving and our profession is evolving or whatever, and we've made some changes, some good, some bad. Some I think will come back and bite us based on cultural changes. But I offer to you the possibility that we've made changes in our profession based on society's needs and not the betterment of our profession. You need to be careful about that. I challenge you to be careful about that. So I had a revelation. They don't really see it the way I do. Now, what I know is that I am part of the past. I'm the old guy. But I'm also a very real part of the present. And there is value in the knowledge that each of you holds in your pocket. And where we've done a really poor job is sharing that knowledge. In fact, we oftentimes just say, they don't get it, they never will get it, so I'm not going to mess with it. This younger generation, I don't know. We got to stop that. I want so badly to be a part of the future, and I think you do too. So we got to share our knowledge, our experience, and influence those around us. If we sit idly by, we have no right to complain anymore. And that's what we do really good. It says fireman on your left sleeve. You're really good at that, okay? Fire person, excuse me, ladies. I don't think we need to do that anymore. I think we need to step forward, make a change, and make it for the better. So you can decide today to literally change this profession if you want to. If you decide to share that knowledge, and you recognize that our world is changing, our profession is changing too. But because it's changing, it's fluid. It's moldable. It's steerable. Don't you want to be part of that? What better time to engage than when it's fluid? Put your foot in and let's see if we can do this. You've got to know that your influence can drive the newest members and it can carry on the traditions that are important to you. We'll talk about traditions here in a minute. But rest assured, today you will begin to develop traditions for the future. You see, the traditions that I'm looking at are the ones that I'm familiar with. Hackensack, Worcester, positive pressure ventilation. Remember that? What? Things that we know that are near and dear to our profession, change our profession, they're being formed today. Now, you need to know, too, that everybody around you will tell you, this is how our society is, will tell you, you can't do that. You'll never succeed. You can try that, Pat. Sounds good, but it'll never work. Not in my department. Well, okay. I also present to you the possibility that if in fact that's your thought, you're right. It'll never change. If you choose to change it, though, and you're willing to, and we'll talk about how you can do that, I think you'll have a significant impact, a significant influence on those around you, those that are under your command, your control, or that are part of your future of either your profession or of your organization. So, given the opportunity, certain people can influence others around them. Now, I'm going to open this video and hope that it works. We've had some struggles with the sound, and so it may just play over here. Is that right, John? It's just going to play on the computer? Do that. I'm trying not to touch anything, but just bear
with me. Well, every once in a while, a story comes along that reminds you just how powerful and wonderful sports can be. One of those special moments took place last night on the basketball court where sportsmanship and human decency collided. In my opinion, it was the play of the year. News Channel 9's Aaron Rich tells the story.
Mitchell Marcus has been a manager for Coronado basketball for 3 years.
I like being with everybody on the team. They're my friends, and they like me too.
Now a senior, the special needs student does everything he can to help the team he loves succeed.
Hey, baby. Like, he's a victory ball.
Head coach Peter Morales decided he would pay back Mitchell for his part in helping the T-Birds to a number one ranking in the city, a chance to dress out on senior night against heated rival Franklin.
Just saw the glare in his eyes of joy, and it's just awesome to see.
But then coach called on number 24 to sub in. What happened next was just short of amazing.
We're up at the end, and I saw Mitchell at the corner of my eye and say, you know what, I need to put this kid in. I need to put Mitchell in. And put him in, got him off the bench, and I just hear the crowd saying, Mitchell,
With just seconds left in the game, Franklin senior Jonathan Montanez passes to Mitchell, allowing him to sink the last shot of the game.
Like, the whole rivalry that I just, like, put it aside and, like, gave him his last shot.
I was so happy then. I made my night.
A moment of sportsmanship, a simple act that became bigger than a rivalry, bigger than the game. A defining moment in the life of Mitchell Marcus. Aaron Rich, News Channel 9 Sports.
Who was the influencer there? It's okay to talk. Heck, I might even pay you. Who knows? Mitchell?
He's doing something that he didn't. He just did because he wanted to do it to help the team.
Okay.
Not expecting anything in return.
Exactly. In fact, well, let's talk about him. Here's a kid that for 3 years supports this team. He doesn't expect anything. That's his job. He's into it. He's got it. He's supporting that team. And when they put him in, it's like, yeah, I should be in the game. You don't seem like going, what, me? No, he just goes, oh, you want me in? Okay, I'm in. That was his job. But I believe that coach was an influencer as well. Here's a coach that recognizes that somebody's done a miraculous job for 3 years, giving his heart and soul to this team, and he looks down and goes, you know what? I ought to put him in. And they're down. They're losing. They've had a terrible season. They really want to win this game. I'm going to put him in. So he puts him in. They try for a few times. You know, they give him the ball. He can't make the basket. So let's play the game. So that influences this other kid on another team. They lose the ball, lose possession. Here Jonathan got the ball. He's supposed to bring it into play, give it to his team. What does he do? Hey, Mitchell. He throws it to him. Mitchell turns around, makes the basket, and they win the game. And in turn, it had an impact on that entire stadium. It's having an impact on you right now, some of you. You see what I'm saying? It's contagious. When we talk about influence, it's contagious. Managing people is one thing. You're managing resources. Leadership through influence is a totally different thing. It's you getting people to do something that they really hadn't planned on doing. They're following you, and they're doing it with a glad heart. Making sense? It's a recap of last year. You need to understand our people, 85-10-5. You've heard this before, but I'm going to go briefly through this. Please know that 85% of your people are the people that you deal with each and every day. Actually, they're very seldom an issue for you. They're not a disciplinary issue or anything like that. But what these people are, these are the folks that will give you 110% while they're on duty. They'll give you nothing when they're off duty. They're not going to come back for the awards banquet. They're not going to come back for the 9/11 parade, anything that's civic, you know, minded, or that the department does on its own time or whatever. And it's not that they don't like the department or whatever. They're just wired that way. As long as you're paying them and they're on duty and they're expected to be there for 24, you're going to get what you got. And 110% of it, you couldn't ask for better people. Boots on the ground, good people. Then you got the 10%ers. What's their role? It's just to burn your house down. They're the issues. They're the problems. They're the people that you're going to spend about 90% of your time just putting out fires. And they don't mean to. They're just wired that way. I'll just tell you, they're just wired that way. Then you got the 5%ers, and that's you. That's you in the room. That's you guys in the back that less than 5 years of service saying, you know, I want to be better. I want to be stronger. I'm going to learn how to do that. I'm talking to y'all. I'm actually talking to everybody in this room. So just know your people. So how do we do this, Pat? Well, first you decide that you're going to have a positive influence on those around you in your department. You're going to understand that you are a leader among future leaders. And there are leaders in every rank, right? Chiefs, captains, lieutenants, drivers, firefighters. There's leaders in every rank. And you need to embrace that. You're no longer going to accept mediocrity. This is a hard one. You'll accept nothing more than excellence each and every time. And I think we fell in this area too. Well, it kind of got done. What do you mean kind of got done? Did the fire kind of get put out? Did the life kind of get saved? Almost is not good enough anymore. You want that excellence. And you need to understand that the future of your organization and the future of your profession and the future leadership skills and abilities of the future leaders within your department are directly related to how you operate today. Whoa, that's a huge responsibility. Do you get that? A huge responsibility on your shoulders. Now, don't get caught up in the stuff work. And here, let me just wrap this for you real quick. How many of you are company officers? Okay, quite a few. How many of you are chiefs? Quite a few. How many of you are firefighters? Okay, well, where's everybody else then? Are y'all drivers? What do y'all do? So you got drivers. Okay, good. Well, so you may ride out of class, but to the company officers, the battalion chiefs, and assistant chiefs and things like that, you just need to know that there's all kinds of stuff work. There's stuff work in my work too, in the chief level, okay? It's a lot more boring than the other stuff, trust me. But anyway, there's stuff work. Don't get caught up in the stuff work. You still got to do hydrants, you got to do station duties, you got to do trucks, you got to do pub eds, you got to do all that stuff. But that's expected of you. You got to do the reports. You got to do the reviews of your people. You get no extra points for doing that. Do you understand? No extra points. Where you're going to set yourself apart from the other people is how you do the other stuff, the real important stuff, how you take care of your people, how you mold and motivate, how you inspire, how you lift up, how you put them in the front of every decision that you, well, you don't put them in front of you, but you, after the decision is made, you give them the glory for being part of that. Does that make sense? If you fail on the regular stuff, the stuff that, you know, oftentimes we look at, you know, I did a good job. I did all my reports today before I left duty. Do any of you still have company officers that leave duty and don't finish their report from the shift before? You do? I don't know. That just baffles me. I don't get that. And so I'm just telling you that if a chief officer sees that, he's not really so concerned about the report, I'll be honest with you. What he's concerned about is, what else didn't get done that affects the safety and the well-being of the people that individual is charged with protecting. Now that's a serious problem. Are you with me? Your people have expectations too. Please don't lose sight of that and know, as I've said before, that they're the future of your profession. City managers, man, they come and go, but they expect that stuff work. In 32 years of service in the of my service in the fire profession, I've worked for 11 city managers. Now do the math. What? What's the tenure, the average tenure of a... Now, I've changed jobs a couple of times too, but I will tell you the average tenure of a city manager is 3 to 5 years. So, secret, we're being videotaped back there, but if you have a bad city manager, just be patient. It's going to be all right. You can outlast him, I promise you, or her. Just hang in there, hang in there. City managers come and go. Please do your job, do it well. You represent all of us, but I'm just telling you that making that city manager happy is important. It is important to your success, but it's not the mission. The mission is to take care of your people within that organization at all costs. And I've said it before, if you're not willing to give your job up when you become ineffective, you need to rethink it. Okay, and to the company officers, opportunities are lost once the TV comes on and the refrigerator door opens up, okay? Yeah, we're going to get to training in a minute. Changing channels, okay? As chief officers, if you're a chief, and many of you raised your hand, already know who you are, you're just like me, we come up with good excuses not to go to the fire station too. I'm bad at that. And I'm busy, okay? I am busy. But I'm telling you, I got to find a way to be unbusy. Because my people need me, at least to show my face. And if I haven't taken anything from this week in Frisco, Texas, I've taken that, and it's in my pocket. And I'll change it when I get back to Taylor. Watch what you're doing. They're watching you. They will mimic you. If it's okay for you to sit down when work needs to be done, they'll sit down with you if you're a leader. Leaders in every rank. But when you're that lieutenant today and you lead the way that you're leading, if you lead that way, 3 or 4 or 5 years from now, when you make battalion chief and you have a poor company officer under your command and control, look back in time and you probably taught them how to be that way. They're watching what you're doing. Now, I will tell you too that a good tactic, if you will, is, I know for a fact that 3 can change 1 quicker than 1 can change 3. Here's what I mean. If I have a weak company officer, I've used this technique before, I'll take that weak company officer out of his environment and I'll put him with 3 very strong firefighters. And generally, the officer molds and conforms and changes and becomes a dynamic leader. I've also used that in reverse where I've had 3 just firefighters, good people, don't misunderstand, but they just didn't get the stuff done, they didn't get anything done. And they lacked leadership, and I've taken a good company officer and I've placed them over there and I've tried to seek change that way. Here's where I caution you. 3 can change 1 close to quicker than 1 can change 3. So if you leave that company officer in that environment without a mentor, they may fail. They may fail. Be very, very cautious at that. I've already said it. It takes a strong leader to enforce the rules. You've heard it. In some of the discussions today, anybody can write a rule. A true leader will enforce it and hold his people to that. That's tough to do. But if you do it, you'll save lives. If you don't, you'll lose a life eventually in your career. You need to be careful. Talk about finding a mentor, and I'm not preaching to you, but these are 3 biblical characters, and Paul, Barnabas, and Timothy. Paul, of course, was a scholar, a follower of Christ, and a leader and a teacher, and a very, very wise man. Wrote the majority of the books in the Bible. Barnabas sought to be like Paul. He wanted to learn, wanted to be stronger in his faith and stronger in his walk. So he sought a mentor, and he did that through Paul. Somebody older, somebody wiser, somebody that had walked the path before, And I always say somebody that admires you and respects you, but they're not necessarily enamored by you. In other words, they don't really like you that much, you know. You're not going to blow anything over on them. That's what you need. You're the Barnabas. You need a Paul. But you also need a Timothy as well, somebody that's younger, that's in the same position as you, or are striving to be like you, if you will. You need to seek that person. My Paul is Steve Bass, City of Grapevine, no doubt. One of my strongest mentors and a strong leader. John Murphy in City of Carrollton. I will call them, or I will to refer back on what they've taught me through my career and try to be better. So you need a Paul, a Barnabas, and a Timothy. We'll talk more about that at another time if you want to do it. You need to align your goals with the goals of the organization. And you've heard it. Did anybody go to the chief of Frisco? What's his name? Thank you. Great discussion, by the way. And he said, you know, you'll never understand your organization until you work 8 to 5. I got to tell you, I was like, yes, sir. I'm telling you, that's true. We you're smiling back there. Are you from Frisco? Yeah, I'm looking at you. Yeah. Yeah, you're smiling. Have you been asked to go 8 to 5? Have you been asked to go 8 to 5? No? Well, you might. Consider it. I'm going to put a good word in for you. How's that? Okay? I will tell you that we've considered that in the city of Taylor, and I introduced it at an officers' meeting, and it didn't go over very well. But we're really considering it for up to a month, that you pull a tour in fire admin, and you'd be given a project, and you attend the meetings, prepare for staff meeting, prepare for council meetings, and maybe even budget preparation or whatever, so that you get a keen understanding of what really does go on. Not that we can say, well, see, now you know my excuse for not making the station, but so you better understand it. And we actually, at my arrival, initiated a light duty program. We didn't have that, and I've had some people pass through there on light duty. I got one there now on light duty, and every one of them that go through that program said, I had no idea. I had absolutely no idea how much goes on over here. So consider that. But you've got to align yourself with that, and if you're not clear on what that mission is or what that objective is, consider doing that and align your goals with the goals of the organization. And understand, too, that the goals of the organization are not always centered around the fire department, because the organization is ultimately the citizens of your city, okay? And there are other departments, other people that you're in competition with. So the weakest link, there were 32 fire chiefs, just scientific data, follow me. I interviewed 32 fire chiefs, okay? And I asked them, what's the weakest link in your organization? All 32 said what? What? Company officer. All 32 said company officer. That's telling. However, again, I got wise, and I thought to myself, well, something's wrong. No. Something's wrong. John, am I running out of battery? Let's just do it this way. What if I polled 32 officers? What would they say? Well, that came out a lot quicker than company officer did. Golly. It's very possible, thank you, that they might say fire chief. And I need to ask that question to my officers. I haven't. I have asked fire chiefs, and overwhelmingly they all said my weakest level of leadership within my organization, which means my weakest link in my organization, is my company officer. We need to fix that. Y'all can help us do that, and we need to help you do that, but you've got to decide today, walking out that door, that you're going to make a difference and change that and have a positive impact, a positive influence. Now, every class I've taught this last year, year and a half, I have asked our students, and if you've heard me teach something else, you've been a party to this, if you've gone to the Texas Fire Chiefs Academy or whatever, you've heard me do this, but I'll usually give a piece of paper out or two pieces of paper out, and I'll ask you to put a 1 on the front side of it, turn it over and put a 2, or an index card or 2 sheets of paper. Put a 1 on that one, put a 2 on that one. A lot of talk. Then I go, I'll tell you what, a sheet of paper I just gave you, turn it where it says 1, and in 1 word, describe your profession. In 1 word, describe your profession. These are battalion chiefs, assistant chiefs, company officers, drivers, firefighters, tenured people, new recruits. Oh, hey, the sheet of paper I gave you? Turn it over where it says two. In one word, describe your organization, your department. That's two words. Now it's green. Now it's green. That's good. Go. Problem? Now, I got to be honest with you. There were on some of those. There were some really good answers on the describe your department. There was, you know, motivated, progressive, strong, but they were very few. Honestly, they were very few. The majority of them, hundreds of them, were those words that you just read. That should be eye-opening to you. It is certainly eye-opening to me. I did the same. I started this in our organization shortly after I arrived. We had a company or a department-wide meeting, and I did that. And those are the answers I got from our organization. And I will tell you, some of those answers would probably still apply today for some. We're working on it. We're not there yet. But we've recognized that we need to make change where change is necessary and where change is good, and do it in a positive fashion. But if you haven't done that in your organization, you might consider it. And then certainly I would ask that you consider, and I'm not, again, not preaching to you, whatever your faith is, but I will tell you that the most important thing I do for our people is I pray. We never break bread in our home without many words of thanks. But in closing, you know, Lord, protect those people that are serving in our department today. Watch over them, care for them, give them wisdom, courage, and strength when necessary. Protect them and send them home safely. I think that's important. But I would ask that you do that for your people, but also do that for your boss. If you're a fire chief in this room, you know that the loneliest place is at the tip of that ladder. And there's often times, and I know, that you go home questioning if you made the right decision that day and what you're going to do tomorrow. And I respect that. And I believe that we need to mentor each other, and we need to work hard to support each other during those difficult times. And we need to tell each other when we make bad decisions, too. My gosh, our people do it. Let's support each other, and let's lift each other up. You can influence the future and those around you. Share your knowledge. Accept only excellence. And you're gonna, again, mediocrity is gone. And there's so much value in the knowledge that you hold in your pocket. In the end, what I'm telling you is your people, where I said, started this conversation with, they just don't get it, they get it. You just need to convey the message a little bit differently. These are highly intelligent people, very motivated, very strong, very willing, very courageous men and women. We've just got to change the message a little bit to get through to them, and then guard some of those changes that we've made. Again, I think we've made some difficult decisions that may not produce good results. This is my statement. We're never too old to learn. We should never be so disconnected that we don't share our knowledge and experience in a way that produces positive, inspiring influence on those around us. So, in closing here, I'm going to tell this story. We're right on time. I just want you to know, as I've always said, I'm speaking to me as much as anything. I don't have all the answers. I haven't written a book. I'll never write a book, I'll just be honest with you. I'm not going to. But I don't have the answers, and I don't know that we can give you the answers today to help you through some of these challenges. But I need your help, and I would ask that you join me. I'll join you, and we work together. We have a huge responsibility, and we need to accept that. So, Max Kinnick, when you heard this story, those of you that were here last year that heard the story already know how we met, and I'll talk a bit about this. But this year, I have a video, and I'm hopeful that this will play so that you can know Max a little bit better. Please play. Okay. It didn't play. Did you like that? Wasn't that great? Okay. That's a video of Max and this teacher. This is at the school. She's saying, Max, do you love me? Tell me that you love me. And the whole time he's raising his eyebrows like he's trying to wink at her, you know. It's just an opportunity for you to get to know him a little bit better. So let me just tell you the story. When we first met Max, he was 4.5 years old. Max was a student at the CDC program, the Child Development Center at the First Baptist Church in Taylor. And they have a wonderful program there, very dedicated educators, teachers. And we do for them what we do for our schools, and that is every October we schedule fire prevention programs for them as well. They're young children, and you know, it's difficult when you have those young kids to do that, but you just make an impression that you have influence on their lives by your presence there. And so we go in, and sure enough, Max is like the first one, the fireman here, and he runs to him, and literally, he is that kid, you know, that's like, now hang on, just wait, and he's clinging to them, but they recognize that he sees them as valuable people in his life. Does that make sense? These are heroes amongst him. He's amongst heroes, and he wants to just be close to them and embrace them. And so they go through the program, and Max is the first to ask questions, and they go outside. He's all over the truck. He wants to put on the bunker gear, look at the helmet, you know, look inside the truck, turn the steering wheel, turn the siren on for me. Can we do the siren? Da, 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 da. It's just a great, great time. And they share that day with all the children, but Max stands out above and beyond everybody. They leave, and then about four and a half weeks later, for some unknown reason, Max becomes ill. He's put into intensive care, later placed on life support, and 6 days after that, this is a city event, by the way, folks. It makes the front headlines of the paper. There's a public outcry for prayer and support for the family. It's a citizen-wide or a city-wide vigil, if you will, for this young child in hopes of his recovery. 6.5 days later, mom and dad are faced with a difficult decision, and they're called in. They have to make that decision. Max is removed from life support, and he dies. 2 days later, Matt Wisnett, who is my honor guard commander, he was here in the first class, comes in and says, Chief, can I ask you a question? I kind of got a strange request. And so he comes into my office, shuts the door. He said, there's a family in our community who's lost a child. Mom and dad have a strange request. I don't know if we can help them or not, but let me just ask you. Mom and dad want to know if we can take Max to his grave on a fire truck. Well, we later learn, of course, that Max's room is covered with fire memorabilia. He's got fire trucks all over the floor, all over, you know, on the shelves. He has fireman outfits, helmets, all that stuff. He has a fire engine red bedspread. This kid loves firemen, fire people, fire persons. Ladies, men, all of you, okay? Don't write letters. Well, I got to make this right. I got to do the right thing. And yet I struggle with it because, as I've said before, if you know me, you know I'm a traditionalist. And I think that's important. And there are certain things that we do for each other that we don't share with anybody else. But this is a request from the family that I really need to consider. And I need to determine the best way to do that. So after much thought, much discussion, as much as you can have in 30 minutes, I determined that the best course of action is to make Max an honorary firefighter. If we do that, we can probably make this happen. And so I give it back to Matt and ask him, because he's the association president, please run this past the guys. Make sure they understand why we're doing what we're doing, and I need their support. And of course, overwhelmingly, he came back and said, absolutely, do what you got to do. Let's make this happen. Let's go to work. I then went to the city manager's office and asked the city manager if I could have his approval on it. And of course, he, without a doubt, said, absolutely, you know, we should do this. I said, well, Jim, you need to understand that you've got to sign it because this is official. So I'm going to swear this cadet in, but you're going to sign that paperwork saying that he is a honorary member. Absolutely, I'm with you. I take it one step further, go to the Williamson County Fire Chiefs meeting, and I don't expect that there would be any kickback on that, but I needed to inform them, and they needed to hear it from me. This is what I intend to do. This is why I'd like to have your support. Every one of them said, absolutely, go to work. You tell me what you need. Pflugerville was even there. They sent some of their honor guard members there. And so we did. So on this November morning, in the First Baptist Church, the fire chief enters the proceedings and begins to swear in his new cadet. And his helmet bearing his name, a certificate of membership signed by myself and the city manager, was then presented to his mother and father. And then, as you do every cadet, he was saluted after being sworn in. And then we took Max out of the church and we placed him on Reserve Engine 11. We didn't use any bunting. We didn't cover our badges. We didn't wear full Class A's. We didn't, a lot of things we didn't do, but we honored this kid. And we placed him in the hose bed of Engine 11, and we covered his casket with his new bunker coat, put his helmet on top of it, and we turned every light that truck had on, and we turned every siren it had on. And it was a proud day because I believe the sirens were never louder. And there were firefighters who gave of themselves, who weren't on duty, that came out and stood on the street corner and watched that truck go by, as I've said, as if it were one of their own, because in fact it was. And we carried Max to his grave. And it was just it's still a proud day. Now here's what I'd ask you to consider in closing, is that I believe Max had an influence on the Taylor Fire Department. He still has an influence on it to this day. He's having an influence on you today. His picture and his certificate of membership hangs on the wall in Fire Admin right next to the pictures of the members that are currently serving that organization today. And he continues to be an influential part of our organization. Now, I'm not asking you to mirror anything that we've done, but I'm asking you to consider that if a 4-year-old child can have an impact on your organization, you can too. So, what an honor it's been to visit with y'all and be a part of this. It's a great pleasure to serve in this profession. If I can serve you in any way, please let me know. I've got cards up here. I wish you the best. Have a great, great, great week. Go forth. Influence. Thank y'all.